Anne is the Ellen Clayton Garwood Centennial Professor of English and Professor of Women's and Gender Studies at the University of Texas, Austin. She's the author of Mixed Feelings, Feminism, Mass Culture, and Victorian Sensationalism, An Archive of Feelings, Trauma, Sexuality, and Lesbian Public Cultures. And she co-edited with Anne Pellegrini, Public Sentiments, a special issue of The Scholar and Feminist Online, and with Janet Steger and Anne Reynolds, Political Emotions. She's been co-editor with Anne-Marie Jagos of GLQ, a journal of lesbian and gay studies, and her current writing projects focus on the current state of LGBTQ archives and the creative use of them by artists to create counter-archives and interventions in public history, a topic that I'm very excited to hear you have to say about. So thank you very much for being with us. Anne's going to lead us in a seminar-style discussion as opposed to a formal presentation, and I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Amy. The reasons that you could glean from Amy's kind remarks, it's very special for me to be here since I was a Rockefeller in 99-2000, so it's 15 years ago. It feels like a very appropriate moment for reflection on that because I am currently also on a fellowship at Cornell this year, so thinking about what those fellowship years can mean and bring to one's work. And certainly the year that I spent at Columbia was transformative for not only the project that I was working on then, it allowed me to really bring oral history into my work in a way that I would otherwise not have been able to do. And the ongoing relationship that I've had with Mary Marshall and with Ron Greeley and with many people who come through the doors of this program, the development of the MA program, working with the September 11th, 2001 project, meeting Amy as a young person and watching her grow up to become the teacher and mentor to you that she is now. I really value the ongoing connections that I've built. And in a way, that's so much in the spirit of oral history because one of the things that an oral history project enables one to do, it certainly was the case with my work with lesbian AIDS activists involved with ACT UP New York and other organizations here. The hunch that I had that doing an oral history project would allow me to build relationships with people as one way of contributing to my scholarly project has more than returned the gift in that I have had ongoing connections with people that I met through that project, and it is also, again, one of the really transformative aspects of the work that I try to do as a scholar, and then also just how I want to live my life by performing what I think of as the aim to have conversation become research, which is another thing that I've been emboldened to imagine as a result of my work with oral history. So, how did the plans for this evening? This is a one-off. It's a live oral event, although it is being taped. Part of the reason for that has to do with your topic for this year, for the series, being medicine, health, and oral history, which is something that I am, of course, very interested in, having written a book that takes trauma as one of its main categories and another book that takes depression as one of its main categories. There's certainly things that I have to say about that, but because I felt that I wasn't currently working on a project that took up those categories, I wasn't sure that I could concoct a formal red paper, and so in my discussions back and forth with Amy, we came to the idea that I could perhaps reflect on the work that I had done, and it's turned out to be very generative for me to have the opportunity to do that. It is, again, partly because I am germinating new projects, and so it's really useful to get to do that. So thank you for that opportunity. So indeed, one of my goals tonight is to use that process of reflection to just underscore and tell you a little bit about where I am now with my interest in, and I think it's one that a lot of you share and is certainly on the agenda for the lecture series this year to think about whether oral history as a practice could be an alternative to medicine. And one way in which that has come up, I think part of the series is connected with the program in narrative medicine, and Rita Sharon is someone who has had the opportunity to share the podium with, I think, at some of the summer institutes, and her work has been very interesting to me. But in addition to thinking about oral history as a kind of narrative medicine, I would want to amplify that to suggest that if it is medicine of a narrative kind, it might also, the value of oral history might lie not just in its ability to produce narrative, but its ability to produce scenes of encounter that include a lot of performative dimensions. We were talking about this in the little session earlier. Affective kinds of exchanges, the material conditions of being in a room with one or more people and trying to make something happen, all the ways in which your body is involved in the process of interviewing and in which you're observing what's going on with someone that you might be interviewing. All of those affective and emotional aspects of the interview process have always been very interesting to me and part of how it does its work. I would say also, and I think just from even getting a little bit of a sense from some of you in this year's cohort of your projects, that many of you are interested in the ways in which oral history might be an alternative to medicine because of its capacity to build relationships, communities. It's not just about communities, I know what some of you are trying to document, but it's also about building alternative social structures, whether because of the relationships you build in the interview process or because of what happens to the material that you gather after the fact. So many of us, I think, try to pay attention not just to collecting the information, but to try to make sure it does some work in the world after it has been collected. So that's one agenda item for the evening, is to think about that question of health and medicine and redefinitions of those terms through the practice of oral history. And then the other main goal, in some ways it may supersede the first one. It's certainly one of the things that we were focusing on in our discussion in the previous hour, is what are the ways in which we could think about oral history alongside what I called in my title other kinds of archives of feeling, and particularly I'm going to have occasion to talk about memoir as a genre or a type of writing that one might put alongside of oral history. And this has also been a very productive site of reflection for me to get a chance to ask myself why and how I did oral history for my Archive of Feelings book, and why and how I practiced a certain form of memoir for my depression book. It's a conversation that I have wanted to be able to have with oral history people. I don't think I've quite done this in this way before, because as someone who is not primarily an oral historian, but whose work has been very inspired by oral history, I'm also wanting to bring to the table some of the many other ways in which we might document people's lives and have oral historians thinking about how the kinds of information they gather, the kinds of archives they produce, might stand alongside of other sources of information so that we can, as I said earlier, think towards the bigger project of what does it mean to produce knowledge, what are our research methods, and I use the term research method in part to legitimate what it is that we're doing as indeed research that could function as important knowledge in the university, but also to expand that category and to think about our research methods and the kinds of products that we create, the different kinds of writing or films, if you make films, or public conversations, if that's one thing that you do, or archives, if you're building archives, how can we expand what counts as knowledge and what counts as the kinds of research we do to get there, especially because the sorts of questions I often find myself asking don't really have very readily available answers. Even something like, and this has been one of my big research projects for forever, what are feelings and why do they matter? It's kind of basic. Try to get a question like that answered in and through the legitimating force of scholarship and disciplinary training, which is something that came up earlier, is, I think, very important and interesting place to try to do some work. So those are my two goals. And I think that before I say more, because you all are involved in the practice of oral history, I thought it would be interesting and in the spirit also of some of the work that I've been doing around writing practice as well as interview to do a little bit of talking and a little bit of writing together before I proceed. So because I'm wanting to talk about oral history and memoir together, I thought it would be interesting for you to do a little talking, do a little writing. And I was thinking that the assignment would just be for you to turn to the person next to you and say, how are you doing? That could be, you know, how are you feeling? That vernacular and colloquial topic. But I also was mentioning my use of keywords as writing practice. And one of the words that came up earlier in our discussion was rigor. So actually I'm going to suggest that you take that as your topic in any way, shape, or form. And so I'm going to invite you to find a partner, and I will time you so that each person gets, let's say, 2 minutes each to say anything that comes up for you around this word, rigor. There's no right answers, no wrong answers, it's just whatever comes into your head. And then we'll proceed from there to have you just write for 2 or 3 minutes about that particular category. Okay? So, my partner, I'll just try to make sure people are matched up. And now, so you don't feel like you had to cut that thought off, get to grab a piece of paper. And a pen. If you don't have one, hopefully someone will share or donate. And so I'll give you 3 minutes to just write in any way you wish about the keyword rigor. You can go anywhere with it. And generally with this kind of writing practice, I ask you to free write, that is to keep your hand on the page and to keep moving and just let the thoughts come as they do. If you're stuck, just say I'm stuck. And keep going. As you can imagine, one reason I wanted you to have the experience of doing those exercises is so that we might have some material to discuss in the Q&A about the difference between writing and speaking as a mode of expression or revelation. If I had given you the topic, how are you feeling? There might be some obvious ways in which you would have ideas or experiences about one mode over the other. One common expectation might be that people would share things writing for themselves that they wouldn't share with others. On the other hand, again, those of you who have done oral history interviewing, I'm sure would be familiar with the ways in which sometimes people are actually able to say things in the context of interview or discussion or public audience that even they might themselves not have expected that they were going to say or even knew. So I don't come to that comparison with necessarily any preconceived ideas about which is the more intimate form or which is the form best suited to the work of trying to document feelings. Since we didn't do that version of the exercise, I'm actually kind of charmed to think about what the difference might be when given the topic of a keyword like rigor. So I hope that will feed into our discussion in some way, shape, or form. But let me continue on with my reflections. So the first stop along the way is just to look back at my Archive of Feelings book, the subtitle of which is Trauma, Sexuality, Lesbian Public Cultures. I know some of you in the room have read some pieces from that for your seminar. I won't presume, I'm sort of presuming that you have some familiarity with that project, but I think I'll probably say enough that even without it, you can follow along. I often tell the story of being brought to oral history by virtue of an interest in the intersection of trauma and testimony, which was a very vital site of interest and activity in my world of literary and cultural studies, particularly building off of important work in Holocaust studies and a kind of excitement about the possibility of testimony as alternative archive, that what people had to say about their memories could be a very important way of doing some work in the world. So I've also found trauma and testimony to be interesting categories of what I also call public feelings, a place where there's room in the public sphere for people to talk about often very painful experiences, to be able to talk about how they feel about those experiences, and for that to be meaningful in a social and political way. I think there are also often claims made for testimony as having a kind of therapeutic power, both on an individual level and a collective level, that if we share this information, a certain kind of repair or healing will take place. We can see this in public institutions like Truth and Reconciliation Commissions. But this is also where, and this came up in our earlier discussion, my training in critical theory also puts me in sometimes a somewhat suspicious mode with respect to the claims that are made for those categories. So I've just found that to be very generative, to not necessarily presume that testimony about trauma is always a good thing, but rather to look at the circumstances under which something like testimony is produced and circulated. And so that was where it was so amazing. And I thank Mary Marshall Clark. I assume a lot of you know her and probably share my affection for just her enthusiasm for knowledge production, her vision in creating the Rockefeller Fellowship I got, which was specifically designed for those who were not oral historians to practice oral history. When I read the mission statement for that fellowship, I not only felt like, oh, that has my name written on it, but that it was a good thing that she was wanting to take the practice of oral history and put it in the hands of people who might otherwise not have the opportunity to do that work. And I'm trained as a literary critic. We read texts, you know, we read literature books. We often read ones that are historically distant. We are not dealing with live people. Mm-hmm. And so I found it really exciting and also sometimes scary and overwhelming to be in the domain of dealing with live people. And getting to ask them questions and find out what they think about stuff. There is that way where I'm committed, even as people were talking about rigor and about the way that the kind of academic training I have allows me to sort of pull oral history into the domain of proper research. I'm often trying to work the other way and say, hey, we all know how to talk to each other. let's try to make something of that capacity to be able to ask questions and sit there and listen to answers and then take that material and try to go somewhere with it. My project at the time was to interview lesbian AIDS activists about their experiences working in the trenches of the fight against AIDS in the 80s and 90s. I came to that also with an interest in activist histories from other eras, so thinking, what is the life of an activist like, and how will it be remembered? So there were a lot of interesting questions for me about community and activism, and also wanting to preserve the memory of activism, but get into the life history in such a way that this was my hunch or my desire to, my intuition, that people would narrate stories of their peak moments of activism alongside a kind of more ongoing framework of a human life or human lives, where there would be undramatic and low moments as well, and ways that those activist experiences might continue to be woven into the fabric of people's lives over time. That was meaningful to me also, to thinking as a kind of child in the 60s and different shattered dreams of activism's gone awry, also forged out of the crucible of all kinds of divisive debates within feminism, wanting there somehow to be space for a lot of different complexities to activism, the failures, the heartaches, the missed opportunities, the paths gone wrong, to be able to mess with those histories and not necessarily to have to tell a triumphant tale of success. Hence also my interest in the darker emotions, sadness, pain, trauma, anger, etc. And part of the sensibility there that's so important as well to the question of health and medicine is the lesson I took also from queer theory, which has been very generative for my academic career, of not assuming certain things to be normal. So simple premise of queer theory is that anti-normativity, and it's had a particular power, I think, when applied to questions of health and medicine, illness, and affective life, to use the tools of queer theory to depathologize the things that have often been seen as non-normative. So, you know, there are no bad feelings that we must judge and dismiss. We have room for everything. And so, for example, in the context of AIDS activism, it was important not to stigmatize LGBT and other lives. It was important to take seriously the experience of illness and also survival that people were carrying into lives very precarious and fraught, and to make space for other kinds of narratives. So that for me is at the heart of the focus of the series on health and medicine, and I'll have occasion, I think, to talk about how that set of conceptual tools continues to be very generative as I think about both my own projects and other projects. It's been a set of tools that I think continues to inform my intellectual life and lived experience. So I embarked on this process of oral history, and there were some hard things about it, even as it was also exciting. One of the hardest things was what to do with the material once I had gathered it. So fun to go do those interviews, even when there were, you know, glitches of trying to track people down, or having equipment fail, or having things be awkward and feeling like I hadn't asked the right questions, or any number of things. I'm sure you all have your own stories to tell about that. But it also, I was joking with a student of mine who's doing interviews now. There's a way in which, even though oral history is considered to be qualitative research, it is also a form of big data, because you have so much stuff. Even if you do a modest number of interviews, I've something like 20 to 25 interviews of, let's say, an average of an hour and a half to 2 hours, but I felt like I was swimming in stuff. And this may be partly from my experience as a literary critic, where we could take one little poem or one novel. I even worked on Victorian fiction, so sometimes they were 900-page novels, and it was a lot of material, but there was still a beginning, a middle, an end, and some technique for being able to make selections about what I was going to talk about. The oral history transcripts were just ginormous, and also there are these live human beings on the other end of them that one feels a sense of responsibility to, and I had walked into that possible hazard knowingly, insofar as I was intrigued by what it would mean to be accountable to the people that one had interviewed, and I wanted to do a good job of documenting their lives and telling their stories, but I also wanted to have my opinions about what they had said. So there was that issue as well, the ethics of research, as I understood them, especially from really lesbian feminist protocols, which in some ways raise the bar even higher on what constitutes ethical accountability. And I wanted to just know what that was like from experience as another mode of learning. So it was fraught for me to find a writing form that would do justice to all of the things that I thought I had learned from people, all of the critical thoughts I had about that stuff, and just to write it up. I somehow found a way. There's still stuff that I was just thinking the other day about a story that got left on the cutting room floor. I think it must have been because I was thinking about having presented that work at one of these seminars, and someone I interviewed was present in the room, and she was really excited about the fact that I had included in my talk some comments she made, in fact, about how early childhood medical experience with scoliosis had informed her her involvement in AIDS activism and in the politics of health. It was a beautiful story that a life history approach made possible in being able to ask an activist where her commitments had come from. And I can't believe that that story didn't make it into the final text, but somewhere along the way, it felt like it was not part of the through line. I don't know what. I was kind of having that reflection and regret just in the past week. So another, for me, quite compelling thought I have had in having the opportunity to reflect on that oral history work here in this context of the Center for Oral History is I haven't really done another oral history project on that scale since then. And it's been 15 years. And if you'd asked me 15 years ago if I would do another oral history project, I'm sure I would have said, oh yeah, let's go. Like, this is fun. So I found it interesting to ask myself why I had that hesitation. I think it does have to do with the logistical challenges and difficulties of dealing with the material and dealing with the people. So just want to say that very humbly, that it gives me a great deal of respect for the amount of time and patience and care it takes to do even the smallest form of oral history project. But I think my particular challenge also comes from being someone who comes to oral history from the vantage point of a writer and a critic who does want to think about what comes after. So it was always very interesting for me to see the work of the Oral History Research Office in building archives of interviews without necessarily having to think about what would happen to them. And I was, you know, very fortunate to be in the orbit of the research office when the September 11th 2001 project was going on. I read a lot of transcripts. I only ever ended up writing one small piece. I again did a lot of work thinking about those interviews, reading them, discussing them with Mary Marshall, with Amy, with a range of different people who had done interviews, and really appreciating what might be the work of simply collecting stuff that others would figure out how to use. But I still have that commitment to wanting to work with the material. And even working with other people's archives or transcripts has also still been a very challenging process for me. Another trick I've tried is in keeping with this idea of oral history as conversation. I've written one piece recently about doing conversational interviews with artists and being able to pick and choose small moments from those interviews to analyze without a commitment to a broad or full-on oral history project. So there are ways in which the practice of oral history continues to inform my work in a really literal way, but I think what I realized considering this is that there's also a way in which my resistance to, or my the capacity to be epistemologically overwhelmed may be one of the biggest lessons that I've taken away from that experience. So I'm gonna turn from that to the next project, Depression, A Public Feeling, and the choice I made there to engage in a kind of personal narrative and memoir. And I wouldn't say that that was necessarily in reaction against oral history. If anything, it was a parallel project of saying, I'm interested in personal narrative, I'm interested in feelings, and you know, there are many different ways to get to that. Also, as you may glean from what I've said, I like the idea of using practice to inhabit theory. So maybe I have a set of theoretical ideas about oral history, or I have a set of theoretical ideas about memoir. And in fact, both of them often produce similar kinds of critique about what is the evidence of a personal life, what are the arguments for it. There's a lot of anti-memoir stuff out there about how it's ruining the market for literature, and it's producing this culture of spectacle where people are confessing their feelings and it's big business because you know, people's inner lives sell. And there are all kinds of, they're important critiques. I don't mean to speak of them dismissively. They've also informed my, you know, push-pull relation to memoir along the lines of what I've said also about testimony as a genre. Some people would also see certain forms of memoir as a kind of degradation of the you know, holier forms of testimony as a way of trying to do some social work around public feeling. So memoir became another practice that I wanted to try for myself in order to see what all the fuss was about, and in order to see what different ways one might be able to make it work. The other reason I turned to memoir in relation to the category of depression was because in my desire to critique the medical model of depression, which in some ways was, again, parallel to a desire to critique medical models of trauma as PTSD. I didn't say too much about that earlier, but that was definitely another variable in, or factor in my desire to think about alternatives to a medical model of there's something wrong with you and you need to be fixed. I had very strong feelings about the promotion of a medical model of depression and the use of pharmaceuticals to treat it, when my strong feeling was that depression was a political problem, that, as I say, you know, capitalism can make you feel bad, the pressure to succeed, or the ways in which people's chances for a good life are severely compromised by capitalist forms of social division and hierarchy. That can be cross-hatched with other longer histories of violence, like colonialism, that I wanted to think about depression in social and political terms. And a lot of the available materials, particularly popular memoir and popular science, were, for the most part, invested in the medical model. Even the memoirs that were written by doctors often were stories of, I took medication and it made me feel better. And a lot of this was also emerging around the coming onto the market of SSRIs, beginning with Prozac and followed up with a whole cluster of drugs in that category that produced a lot of public debate and discussion around, you know, how we found the cure, we got the pill, and everything will be fine. So I wanted to get in there and find a way to produce an alternative account without necessarily doing a big scholarly critique. So I wanted to see what my own experience of what some people would call depression and what I wanted to call a kind of creative impasse might mean. And the other important variable here was telling a story about what academia can be like and the ways in which it can produce a sense of stasis, stuckness, sense of life or one's work having no meaning. There just were a whole series of, someone unknown is trying to call me, questions and issues I had that were in my daily domain. So again, this is maybe another hallmark of my work, is like to look around and see, okay, what is the kind of knowledge and set of questions I'm bringing with me to my daily life? And one of the other kinds of stories I wanted to tell that relates to our question of rigor is that depression might, or the experience of what gets called depression, might have something to teach us. Rather than, again, pathologizing or stigmatizing those feelings, we might find ways to open up to them and to come to the world in a different way, both individually and socially. So I engaged in a practice of trying to tell that story, and we can maybe talk more about this in the Q&A, because it seemed like there were a lot of people in the oral history cohort who were interested in questions about the practice of writing. I, again, had a kind of fun and also hell with trying to write in a different way, trying to just very simply, as you've done with your 3 minutes of writing, take a particular story or a particular memory and meditate on it. And one of the key things I decided I wanted to put out there for discussion around the pretty obvious question generated by my presentation, what's the difference between oral history and memoir, I would say for me that one of the things that memoir enabled was a kind of pressing of the pause button in order to meditate on particular moments or particular memories or sometimes particular objects. This is where the archive of feelings concept comes in again, in a way that I'm not sure I would have been able to do if someone were interviewing me about my experience or if I were trying to write a beginning, middle, end narrative. So the depression journals in my book was written more as a set of short pieces. I also found that very enabling for my writing practice to just try to do that as opposed to writing something longer and more coherent. So that for me was valuable, and also this has been another important part of the work that I have done with other scholars and fellow travelers, particularly in the domain of queer affect studies, is to focus on ordinary feelings. So I felt like the writing practice allowed me to turn to the ordinary or the seemingly banal or the low-level moments. And I did circulate belatedly some of the sections from the memoir, things like a trip to the grocery store, trying to get up in the morning. You know, often that is named publicly as a symptom of depression is, you know, you can't get out of bed in the morning. But I kind of wanted to get in there with that. Like, what does that feel like not being able to get out of bed in the morning? It's, you know, it sounds so simple on paper, and yet to try to get inside of the somatic and material feel of that experience was something that I wanted to do with the writing practice. And this is where I think interesting issue for our discussion would be, how could you take that kind of sensibility and feed it back into the practice of oral history? That's one of the questions I've been asking myself in thinking about the two genres together, and also is sort of, I don't know, if I have a message or as part of this cross-disciplinary or cross-modal or genre conversation we're having, when I get to come talk to the oral history people, it's always this great two-way street where I'm so inspired by your projects, and then I'm thinking, okay, what would I want you to take from me and, you know, go into the field with, since I'm not going to be able to do the 5 million oral history projects I wish I could do? You know, what, how could you take the sensibility of memoir, that kind of drilling down into particular moments, that attention to the affective dimensions of experience within at least some versions of memoir that are more interesting to me, less the sort of melodramatic conversion narrative of, aha, you know, this amazing thing happened and everything changed, but a memoir that's more attentive to the rhythms and motions of the that thing that might seem insignificant, but in fact is worth our attention. And oral history does do this. I find when I work with transcripts, that often I am looking for those moments that might seem relatively low level or insignificant, but that pop out, especially if you've been in the room and you can sometimes, again, sense at a more affective level something important there that you might easily pass over if you were just looking at a transcript and looking at what was said, just at the level of word or narrative. So that's one of the things I wanted to throw out for our discussion based on my brief account. I have by no means exhausted this, of what it has meant for me to practice these two modes in my two different books. And then I want to throw out a couple more things. There's time, yeah. I'm trying to do this in maybe 5 or 10 minutes. About where I'm thinking now about these issues. One place that I've been doing some further reflection on the depression project, in terms of sort of where I would go next for thinking about questions of health and medicine, is the really rich and vital work that's going on in disability studies right now, which was really exploding as I was writing the depression book. And in a variety of different directions, among them the rise of sometimes called queer crip studies. I would recommend, for example, a book by Allison Kafer called Feminist Queer Crip that takes, again, that principle from queer studies of challenging normative notions of health or well-being or bodily integrity or somatic experience, and instead asks, what is it like to experience the world from the vantage point of disability, and what can we learn about not just humanness, but actually non-humanness or interactions with our environments that put humanness in contact with non-humanness, with the object world and so on. Another book that's been really important to me in that regard is a book by queer theorist Mel Chen called Animacies that takes up, for example, chemical sensitivity as a different way of experiencing the porous boundaries between our bodies and our environments. And I think of depression as, in a sense, also something like a chemical sensitivity disorder, where we are kind of absorbing our environments in ways that are simultaneously material and immaterial. And in fact, that attention to the integrated relation between body and mind or psyche, which has been part of the work of affect studies, I think, also to present new models of, is present, I think, in disability studies as well, as it rethinks what it means to inhabit a body or a mind or both simultaneously. And one of the other real areas of growth in disability studies has been thinking about cognitive and mental disabilities alongside of physical or somatic disabilities, and indeed challenging distinctions between those, to think of them as quite mixed up together. So I do find myself wanting to think about how the category of disability might be another way to think about these questions of what it means to live and to live well, that have been part of my interest in categories like trauma and depression, however critically I want to view those categories. And indeed, disability itself is a very interesting health category to think with, insofar as there has been, I think, a real opening up of that category to no longer just be a simple identity category, but really, or a stigmatizing category, but rather to be something that we might think of as available to all of us to learn from. So now, this is touching down on some interesting ways in my life that I wanted to think about in terms of oral history, conversation, the said, the unsaid, and ordinary encounters. Where I find myself thinking about this is around accommodations for students with disabilities in universities and classrooms, where more and more students are presenting with official status, disability status for cognitive and mental disabilities. Although because of the nature of the protocols for disclosing or not disclosing those disabilities, often as a teacher being handed a letter saying the student needs additional time to complete exams or needs consideration with regard to attendance in class, etc., I don't know what that disability is because they do not, it totally makes sense why there would be the need for confidentiality or to protect students around what they feel comfortable disclosing or not disclosing. But I think it also creates some interesting dilemmas for how to really grapple with the issue. And also my concern, building off of my critique of the medical model in the depression book, is that students are being given and also taking up diagnoses in ways that don't really address the sources of their suffering in, for example, the very academic institutions themselves that they are trying to gain access to. So the challenge of really accommodating those disabilities goes so much far beyond just an extension on a paper deadline or not taking marks off for absences from class. So I think we have a real problem on our hands. And I really want to think about where and how the category of disability helps and then also possibly obscures some of what's at stake there. And some of that comes from the kind of knowledge I get through conversations with students when they are willing to say more than the letter of the law asks them to say. But it's a kind of anecdotal knowledge of how it is that people negotiate institutions that I'm not quite sure what to do with. But I have thought, oh, if I really want to press this, would I do interviews? Because this is a place where I am definitely at odds with some of the prevailing ways in which people understand their identity. So it is a place where I can imagine a quite productive form of some kind of oral history where I would want to put aside the more polemical subjective voice that I was able to use in the depression book, where I was just speaking for myself and I wasn't presuming to have to judge other people's narratives. In this instance, I find myself thinking, I probably need to pause and think about where other people are taking up these categories, perhaps in different ways I would, and be able to perhaps have some exchange or encounter around that. So that's one way in which I would say I'm by no means done with oral history. I can imagine places where I would want to do a kind of interview to continue to think about these tough problems of health and medicine and the depathologization of what gets named as illness. But I also want to just end with the question of anecdotal knowledge or these sort of ordinary encounters as another place where we learn something like what we also learn and perform through oral history and memoir. And I continue, as someone interested in the practice of writing, to also wrestle with the question that I said I wrestled with in particular in trying to marshal a whole bunch of interview material into some piece of writing. I continue to think about, this is why I'm working on archives now too, how we take our materials and put them into some kind of form. And since I'm a writer, that's my form. Since I am, in some version of my hats, a literary critic, I'm a bad literary critic, sometimes an unfaithful one to literature, and yet still in many ways able to claim the category. I have been thinking a lot about creative nonfiction and other forms of experimental writing as a way that certain kinds of conversations or oral knowledge might be transmitted or not. And as an example of how complicated this is, I wanted to share with you a couple of pages from Claudia Rankine's Citizen, an American Lyric, which just came out this year and has already been nominated for a number of awards. I was particularly interested in the fact that she was doubly nominated. I believe this is the first time this has happened in the categories of both poetry and criticism for the National Book Critics Circle Awards. And she's being heralded in some versions of the press or buzz around this book as someone who has managed to find a way to document, document moments of what I would call ordinary racism, which is a category or a term I also use in my book. The term microaggression is being used a lot. I'm not crazy about that term because I think it also tends to, put a diagnostic on something that is quite diverse and mobile and in need of the kind of particularity of storytelling that I'm interested in, and that Rankine, as someone who's trained as a poet and has a very acute sensitivity to language, manages to put into play. This is just a couple of, I'm sorry it's so randomly selected. Please go buy the whole book. I bought it and passed it around. It's quite interestingly laid out, and it has a lot of interesting visuals, which is another thing I'm interested in, is how can we make language do different things by combining it with the visual. I'll just read a few lines from this opening. Certain moments send adrenaline to the heart, dry out the tongue, and clog the lungs. Like thunder, they drown you in sound. No, like lightning, they strike you across the larynx. Cough. After it happened, I was at a loss for words. Haven't you said this yourself? Haven't you said this to a close friend who early in your friendship, when distracted, would call you by the name of her black housekeeper? You assumed you two were the only black people in her life. Eventually, she stopped doing this, although she never acknowledged her slippage. And you never called her on it, why not? And yet you don't forget. If this were a domestic tragedy, and it might well be, this would be your fatal flaw, your memory, vessel of your feelings. Do you feel hurt because it's the all black people look the same moment, or because you are being confused with another after being so close to this other? The literary critic in me wants to talk about a lot of different stuff going on here. The oral historian in me is going to pause over a few things. But one is the use of the you, the second person, as a way, I think, of not using the eye of memoir, but being able to allow experience to float in this kind of intersubjective space that could involve the self, could involve a kind of dissociation from the self, because I think we sometimes use the you when we mean I, but we don't really want to inhabit that body that's having that experience. But in that process of splitting the self, one also multiplies or proliferates the self and brings it in contact with a third person or an other, so that you could be a kind of invitation to join in the process of that experience. She's also so attuned to, she's not just telling the story of these incidents, I feel like she is mapping the impact of those stories on the body. So the opening with certain moments send adrenaline to the heart, dry out the tongue, and clog the lungs. So the way that a kind of listening or taking in certain words happens at a somatic level is for me really important as this constant challenge to the work of oral history as not just discursive language or conversation, but as something that happens at a somatic level. And her attention to things that get said that shouldn't be said, things that get not said that maybe should be said, this process of, and never called her on it, why not, and yet you don't forget. So how is it that things inhabit a space of the unsaid and yet linger on in a memory that is, in her view, a kind of archive of feelings? I think at one point she talks about a kind of storage container in which these things reside, like a kind of closet inside of the self, is, I think, a very interesting model for the complexity of the relation between the spoken, the unspoken, and a lived experience that happens in places other than just words. The next one, yeah, there's a lot to say here. I may just have you, I don't think there's time for me to read the whole thing out loud, but she has a really interesting way of setting talking and driving together. That's another way of thinking about conversation as something that happens in a physical space where this other activity is happening. And then she talks about having to listen to this, again, moment of ordinary racism. A friend or a companion who says his dean is making him hire a person of color when there are so many great writers out there. As someone who lives in the academy, I've had to be witness to many moments like this, including as a white person. So one of the things that's also interesting for me about Rankine's work is what it means for me to be privy to these anecdotes and to have to live in also in the presence, albeit in a very specific way, of ordinary forms of racism that pervade all of our lives. This was one of the things that I was trying to find a language for in my depression book. It continues to be a struggle for me that informs this kind of work of documentation. And then the way that she closes, again with the medical model of John Henryism, a medical term for people exposed to stresses stemming from racism, and her desire to sit in silence in order to buck the trend. She says, "You fear the night is being locked in and coded on a cellular level and want time to function as a power wash." Just that set of images for what it means to take certain things in, to try to sit with them, and to try to process them in some way. What would be the mode of speaking that could accomplish that work of here, what she describes as a kind of silence and having to take pause? I think this gets at different forms of everyday experience that are very important to me to document, and trying to find a set of genres that would be up to that task is, I think, very difficult. And so I wanted to just put on the table this question of writing in alternative forms. This goes far beyond memoir. I'm very interested in a research and writing practice that bucks at the prevailing notions of rigor, sometimes by using the first person or the subjective voice, but I think there's many other ways in which one could find alternative writing practices that would do some of this work. And that, again, is this broader context or set of methodological and affective and knowledge-building problems that I would want you all to perhaps think of your oral history work in the context of, and again, to think, okay, it's a big question I'm asking, but what the hell were you around? You know, what can oral history do within this broader context of what I'm calling kind of archival media for being able to document felt experience in order to say, you know, how we are living in the present and how to survive and also how to make change.
Awesome. Thank you.